War, interrogations, the search for justice are all difficult topics. We're joined now by Professor of Politics at Catholic University of America, John White, to talk about the controversial topic of Guantanamo Bay. Thank you so much for joining us, Professor White. Can you give us a brief overview of the way that Guantanamo has been treated by different administrations? And is there anything like this in the world for a free nation?
Thank you. Pleasure to be with you. Guantanamo has been treated quite differently by Democratic and Republican administrations. As we know, it was set up during the George W. Bush administration. Barack Obama promised to close Guantanamo, but Donald Trump reversed that promise and said that he would do everything he could and did to keep it open. Joe Biden has also promised to reduce and eventually close Guantanamo. And we've seen during the Obama and Biden administrations a reduction in the number of detainees at Guantanamo Bay. Guantanamo has not only vexed presidents, it's vexed the Congress, particularly as Congress has tried to intervene to impose some restraints on interrogations and so forth at Guantanamo. So it remains a problem for different administrations.
We just watched a very emotional interview with a former interrogator who talked about the limits and the way that Congress and also just in general policy devises limits on what is actually available for interrogators. And as a matter of national security, then, what are those limits? How do you draw those lines on interrogation and moving from interrogation to pressure, coercion, and abuse when you're trying to extract information that could save lives?
Well, this has been a huge problem, and it's a problem, as I said, that has vexed the Congress. Back in 2005, Congress passed the Detainee Treatment Act. It was led by John McCain, of course, who had been a prisoner of war during the Vietnam War and been badly abused by the North Vietnamese. And what the legislation tried to do was to basically ban certain types of treatment. McCain particularly had in mind waterboarding, which had become a political issue. A problem with that legislation was that it really didn't define what constituted abuse very well. President George W. Bush signed that legislation because he knew that given the overwhelming votes for it in the Congress, that any veto would be easily overridden. But what he did do was issue a signing statement that tried to define what constituted torture and what didn't, that basically gave wide berth to the interrogators. So Congress has not been particularly effective in trying to limit actions or interrogations by detainees to draw certain boundaries. And there's been, I think, increased emphasis or at least a realization that perhaps the uses of torture don't necessarily lead to results or information that is actually accurate. In other words, the detainee may say anything simply to have the abusive treatment stop.
Out of desperation. We talk about trying to set those limits, and those limits many times come from the influence of morality. Many countries around the world still perceive the United States as a Christian nation, or they expect that from diplomats and from what we share. Does the Guantanamo narrative influence our global reputation and the values that we export?
Well, it does, because it actually has been somewhat, not somewhat, it has been detrimental to our international reputation in particular, especially in the Middle East, because again of these particular abuses that occur and that then come to light by the interview that you just referenced. So this is something that has actually hurt the United States, but it presents a certain conundrum for the United States because these are actors, non-state actors that are being detained there. They're not the conventional prisoner of war. And thus it opens up a whole category of ambiguity as to how the where these prisoners should be held, how they should be held, what sorts of trials that should be undergone, and what to do in terms of releasing them. Do you release them back to the host country, like Saudi Arabia, for example? Where do you put them? And so while the numbers have diminished substantially, we still haven't really come to grips with the idea that we have these non-state actors that don't, because they're not prisoners of war and the Geneva Convention doesn't really apply, it does present a huge problem for us.
And the Guantanamo narrative isn't necessarily a deterrent. Really quickly, what is the likelihood that the remaining prisoners will be transferred and the facility will close?
Well, I think it's almost inevitable that something is going to happen here. Now, again, this is where you have had resistance from the Congress or elements of the Congress to close it, but you've had the desire now of two presidents basically to reduce those numbers of prisoners and transfer them back to some other country. I think that the international problems that Guantanamo now presents or has presented are really compelling at this point.
Well, we'll be watching it closely, and we're grateful for your analysis. Thank you, Professor.
Thank you so much.